Hi, it's Jeff.
And Denise from Mousesteps.com.
And this is episode number 294.
294.
Of Mousesteps Weekly.
Sponsored by MEI Travel and Mouse Fan Travel. We're looking forward to another year with MEI Travel and Mouse Fan Travel. I'm really happy that they signed on for another year.
Me too.
And so Christmas is almost over. We're still going to be talking about it a little bit, though we're trying to do more than that. But definitely for the Epcot Festival of the Arts, the Epcot International Flower and Garden Festival, this is a time to start booking all of those travels.
Never too early for Halloween.
You know what? It's a little too early. It is a little too early for Halloween. I'd wait till those Halloween party tickets come out in a few months.
So be sure to go to their website and sign up for the mailing list for the very latest news from MEI Travel and Mouse Fan Travel.
And we're going to be heading into Epcot. We're running a little late this week, and I'll discuss that just a tiny bit at the end of the show. But here is the Epcot Festival of the Holidays. We're there again just for a couple of hours the other day. And one of the things I really wanted to do was the Living with a Land boat ride, because this is something that is not promoted, but they do a really nice Christmas and holiday displays inside the greenhouses.
Right, and they've been doing this for a number of years, and I think this is the best ever. Now, this part of the ride doesn't have any kind of overlay yet. It would be nice to see little Santa hats maybe on the alligators, perhaps.
Buffalo. I'm not expecting that. Living with the Land is one of my favorite attractions at Walt Disney World anyway. So it's really nice always to see the holiday editions. And they do a little bit also for like the Epcot Flower and Garden Festival and for Halloween. But really for Christmas, it is much more.
You know, much like at Disneyland Paris, a Small World holiday, also not advertised. We talked about that during the last show. So I like these little surprise and delight. And here we have some snowmen, a whole family of snowmen.
But there's no snow. It's probably sand, or it would be something similar to that. And usually, or always, it's only been one sandman, snowman, and now it's a family. And then on the other side, we saw a display. And this has been here, I think, for a few years, just kind of these decorations here by the waterfalls. And the lighting in here this time is much better, much more enhanced than last year. Not only the light set right now we're seeing on, you know, I don't even know what you call this, like a trellis?
Like a truss or a trellis, yes.
Right. But also they do lighting, they have a lighting package inside. Like the trees will turn.
Well, you'll see it right here.
Such.
You have some green, you have some purple, some Christmassy colors, and you'll see a lot more of that, especially if you go during the evening hours.
Well, we were there for late afternoon, and then all of a sudden it was evening, like within a half hour, yeah, because we rode it twice. So we were able to see just one on top of the other, the difference going through the greenhouses. And here, they used to have alligators in here. They haven't had them for probably a few years now, but they still have fish. And you can see there are green lights, the green holiday lights, going through the greenhouse.
And you're about to see some more Christmas lights up here. And I think there'll be a little mini mouse, a hidden mini. There it is. They're a little hidden mini with the crabs.
Yeah, I didn't see any extra decorations inside of these, but yeah, you can see the shrimp. They grow like two shrimp at a time in there. So there's also, like, you can see the sunflowers as wreaths. They make a number of different items as wreaths. There's a cotton wreath, and then they also have, I don't know if we're gonna see it, but like a pepper wreath. So it's really fun to see the different types of vegetables and fruits they use.
It looks like a giant reindeer, but a Mickey reindeer.
Right. Well, it's funny because I don't even see Mickey. It's a Mickey plant, but I don't think of Mickey. I just think of the reindeer. Mm-hmm. And in the past, they've had the red nose, like, yes, Rudolph, but they don't have that this year.
You have to give all the other reindeer a chance to shine, too.
I don't know which reindeer that is, but you can see all the lights. And if you do this like at right before closing, it will be darker and you'll see even more lights. But then it's harder to get the photos. And we just passed a Mickey pumpkin, and they grow them back there. They have, it's like a plastic thing. They put a container that they put those pumpkins in to make a Mickey shaped.
And if you really like this kind of thing, you can take the behind the scenes tour. Now would be a great time for that because you get this bonus holiday overlay.
I actually like the behind the scenes tour a lot. I just do it every so often. And here is, you can see more of that lighting that you'll see, especially if you go, I think the Living with the Land closes at like 7. So mm-hmm. if you go at like once or twice starting around 6, you'll see the difference. And then you have the Christmas tree lights here.
Some gifts.
And right, there's a number of different displays like that through the greenhouses. And then as we're coming up here onto the biotechnology area, you see that there are snowflakes, there's ornaments, and there's stockings hanging. And I think one of them says Justin. I don't know who Justin is, but I posted that earlier in my article.
So what a nice little bonus. I think that's great. And, you know, we went on twice, as you mentioned before, and I probably could have done it a third time.
Well, we had a Frozen Ever After Fast Pass, and I was just like, I just want to do this
yeah,
again.
Yeah, we passed on that. We chose the land. Now we're going to head over to Disney's Hollywood Studios, though, for a special event that we were able to do.
Well, we were invited to Disney After Hours. We could have done the Animal Kingdom one, but we were out of town until that day. But we were able to do Disney's Hollywood Studios, and this was actually a really fun time. We got there just a tiny bit early, and you can on your ticket. I believe 7 o'clock is when you can actually enter in. And we looked at Echo Lake, which is really one of my favorite places at Walt Disney World now for the holidays. It's just very classy and just really beautiful to me. And then you have Santa Gertie, and then the reflection of the Christmas tree.
Yeah, the word I use is charming. It's just a delightful delightful area.
So we came to Toy Story Land first. Our evening Disney After Hours started at 8:30. Sometimes it's 9, but usually it is not, and it's mostly Saturdays through April 13th, and there's a few Saturdays I think not included. So it was empty. It was really empty. And I don't think we waited more than 6 or 7 minutes for Slinky Dog Dash.
Well, this was right at 8:30, right when the party began. And you could see it says 15 minutes. No way was it 15 minutes. It was maybe 5 to 7 minutes and we were on the Slinky Dog.
And I really love this ride. I only rode a few times on this evening. You probably rode
how many?
8 times. So you and Matt, especially at the end of the evening, we kind of sat there and watched you go. And so, there are days that I can do more, but on this day I was sort of not. So it's really the line. This is the biggest line. Honestly, this is the biggest line we saw all night.
Yeah,
here.
It's just that's the whole beauty of this after hours. It's amazingly empty. So we were able to choose what Slinky Dog spot we wanted. If we wanted to do the front, the back, the middle, I think I at least rode almost every row. And how awesome is that?
And I just really enjoyed Toy Story at night, Toy Story Land at night. I have not been here as much at night yet. And it was just a perfect evening for us. There was lighting. And also, the last time that we did Slinky Dog Dash, they had the sleigh bells, but you couldn't hear them on the coaster. So that was really fun because this time...
Much louder.
It's
yes.
Much louder. So you actually hear the sleigh bells, the little holiday overlay of Slinky Dog Dash. I mean, it's not much of an overlay, but it's really fun to hear those bells.
So I guess my advice would be if you are wanting to do a variety of attractions, I would save Toy Story Land until the last hour or 90 minutes, because at that point there was almost nobody there. And I was able to ride Slinky Dog Dash 5 times in the last half hour of the party. So think about that. You could hit 15 times in 90 minutes if all goes right on your night.
And not all attractions are open. So if you can't really say, okay, this is my day ticket, because there are going to be attractions like Voyage of the Little Mermaid that are not open. But if really your main goal here is like Toy Story Land, Tower of Terror, Rock and Roller Coaster, Star Tours, none of that for us. Only Slinky Dog Dash, I think, had to wait for us. And that was almost not at all. But like when we went to Tower of Terror, we waited not at all. Or you waited not at all, because I didn't do that one. And Rock and Roller Coaster was a walk-on.
Right, and you didn't even have to watch the pre-shows. They just had the doors open. You were able to just walk in. And if there was nobody there when your car ended, you could just stay on as far as Tower of Terror.
And actually, when we did Alien Swirling Saucers, which we'll see in a little bit, that we could have stayed on as well. And I don't think you guys heard that, or else I probably would have.
So here are some pictures showing the Slinky Dog Dash towards the last half hour. As we talked about before, you could see pick your own row. There I am with a good friend, Matt, there from Attractions Magazine. He and I went around over and over again, and it was a lot of fun.
And I was the one who took that picture. And I don't think, until we were in the seat, I don't know that we stopped. Really, if you love something like Slinky Dog Dash, which I do, this is a fantastic coaster. I definitely recommend the Disney After Hours, because it really allows you to keep going around and around and around. You don't have to wait like an hour to hour and a half or more.
And look at this giant line here at Alien Swirling Saucers.
That was even less of a line. So there was no line.
Well, we were able to have our own alien saucers every time. Just pick whatever one you want. All three of us had our own.
I didn't have to sit with Jeff. So
no. That's a big bonus for Denise.
No, it's... But so we could have just sat on it probably for, you know, a bunch of times if we wanted to, and we didn't. Everybody was sort of on their way out, and I heard the cast member say, "Hey, you could stay on," and that would have been fun to maybe do it once more. So
If I had heard that, then I would have stayed. Why not?
So it was, you know, this was really fun. Toy Story Land is a harder land to be able to go over and over again on rides. So this was really terrific. And also, Toy Story Mania had, like, no wait all night either. We didn't even ride that. I did about 10 rides all night, which sounds...
Well, we had just gotten back from our Paris trip, and we kept running into friends, so a little bit of socializing held us back. I shouldn't say held us back. I quite enjoyed it.
I mean, there was more, you know, more for me as well, but it was nice to... I just wanted to go at a moderate pace on this night. So Woody and Jessie was one of the only lines I saw all night, and I think none of the other characters had lines, but Woody and Jessie were popular, so it was probably at least like 10 minutes.
Did we mention treats are included?
So there is a number of different ice cream items, including the Mickey bar and Mickey ice cream sandwich, which is what I got. And then also there's bottled beverages. Here is my Mickey ice cream sandwich.
Oh boy, that looks good.
You know, I almost never buy them, so it's nice to have that included. But also you can get popcorn, which can come in a box or in this container. And also, they didn't just have the bottled beverages, but the fountain beverages. And I actually like the fountain. I like having a little bit of ice with my drink. So that was really nice. And here's Sunset Season's Greetings, which is way different for me than last year, because last year it was really just on the Tower of Terror. And now you've got the lasers and the snow. And it actually makes some really fun effects. It's a little harder for a picture sometimes back here. So I just get closer to the Tower of Terror if I just want the tower. You can do it either way.
Well, you know, it wasn't advertised that this would be running during the event, so I thought it was a very nice bonus. Nobody there, especially later on in the event, so if you really want to get some nice pictures or have a tripod or anything like that, perfect time to do it. And I know we mentioned the beverages and the food before, but unlimited, all you want, fully included. I want to make sure we mention that.
And here is the Tower of Terror, and that's where we were on our way to, and you rode with Jackie and Matt?
Yeah, and I think Lou also was on it. There we all are. So it was a fun ride on Tower of Terror as all. And they said if there was nobody waiting, we could stay on.
And was there anybody waiting?
I think there might have been. So at this point, we all got off. But eventually, you could have ridden. I talked to people who were able to stay on and ride it.
You know, I just love that. And then here we are on the Rock and Roller Coaster. If we had been told we could stay on this, I probably would have just once. But this was really fun. And we, again, no wait. We walked right up. And that was it.
Yeah, you didn't have to watch the pre-show, which that would be a really nice addition in Pandora for a Flight of Passage.
And
maybe
it was.
If you can just walk through that. Yeah, we weren't at that event, so that would have been a nice bonus for that one.
Well, while we're at Muppets Courtyard, I'm just going to mention the Magic Kingdom and Disney's Animal Kingdom both have the Disney After Hours, and they're on different dates. They're not like Saturdays. So just check online.
I will link to your article in the show notes.
Yes, and Flight of Passage is included with, and I don't know that you have to do, I don't know if they have to do the pre-show
right,
on
that's
that.
What I was getting at. So if you don't, that would be a great bonus.
Well, it saves a fair bit of time. You can just ride over and over again, which is something you can never do with Flight of Passage. So there is Disney After Hours, a sign, and we had, it was a really fun evening. It is something that I would pay for. It's, what, $95 for pass holders in DVC or $125 normal. And I think that actually you can do more rides in 3 hours than you can in a full day. And because of that, I think it's a good value.
Right. You could just go crazy and ride, 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 or you can have a very nice, relaxed night in an empty park. So to me, either option sounds very good.
I would do it again, and I would pay for it next time.
So here we are back at Disneyland Paris for part two of our Christmas coverage. And now we're at the Walt Disney Studios Park. And this is Studio One here, beautifully decorated for Christmas.
Both parks at Disneyland Paris do a wonderful job for the holidays. And so there are several different events here, including Mickey's Big Band Christmas. Right now, again, we're looking at Studio One. This is a great place to come into if it's cold and wet and rainy, which it was almost every day, at least cold, wet, rainy, pretty much all of it, almost every day.
Yeah, come for the park and stay for the weather. I think I used that joke last time. And here's something we did not try, the Noel menu.
No, it didn't look more like my type of food, so we did other things instead. But there are some holiday menus.
And the partner's statue with all the Christmas enhancements. And now we're going to meet Minnie Mouse in her Christmas attire.
And Minnie, it's called Line Birdie, there's an app called Line Birdie, and you have to go through that to be able to meet, so I think all the characters.
At the studios,
except for like Remy and Emile, who are just out and you just get in line.
Right.
But Minnie is very popular, and so we went on the app and we reserved our spot.
Like
here
4 hours later, by the way. You have to do it first thing in the morning. That is my recommendation. She looks great, though, in her Christmas outfit.
She was really fun. She has a terrific outfit. Minnie has so many. She must have like a dozen to two dozen costumes for the holidays, including like four for just Big Band Christmas.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Can you imagine her closet?
No, I
just the can't. Shoes.
And so anyway, we had a great time. Were we here with Matthias?
No, we were here with Fan Max.
Oh, that's right. We were here with Max. I hate to say, we have a lot of friends that isn't Paris area, so it was really fun to get to see them and Minnie Mouse.
So anyway, that was Minnie, and now we're going to go over to the Ratatouille area and meet Remy and Emile.
So this is I don't know if you say it, Place de Remy. This is Bistro Chez Remy, and then there Linguini was supposed to be out also at times, but he wasn't. We never saw him.
We never saw Linguini, but we've seen him before, so that's okay.
But Remy and Emile are meeting during, they call it, L'Hiver, which I believe is L'Hiver, is what they call it. It's like a winter, kind of a Christmas market that they have here. And then Remy and Emile, I think they're meeting during this whole event, which could be into March. It's not just for the holidays that they're having the Christmas market area.
Well, when you walk through there, it just smells so good because there's so many different foods being cooked there or heated up, whatever they do. It's just really nice.
I think they do. There I am. I think they do more cooking than they did last time. They have mulled wine and they have sausage and all kinds of different items, and we tried a little bit.
And it looks even prettier at night, and we're going to show that after we see the big band beat, the Christmas big band beat.
And also Disney Village, if you head over to Disneyland Paris at this time, has a Christmas market. So
you patronize that quite often, I remember.
I did. I bought a few things there. I really enjoyed that.
Oh, it's actually called Mickey's Christmas Big Band. I don't know where I got the beat. Maybe that's what they call it in Tokyo.
They have Mickey's Big Band beat in Tokyo. They've had the Christmas version. This is where that comes from. But they have like 30 people on stage, which is amazing. Like 30 performers on stage, including the band. Eventually, we'll see Mickey. This is just a wonderful show. I can't find facts and figures for it or anything, but they have all kinds of singers. We have characters and Mickey playing the drums.
It's very repeatable. It's something that I could see over and over, and I tried to see it almost every day that we went to the Walt Disney Studios. Just a great, great show.
And if you've ever been to Tokyo Disneyland, which I have not, I know that the big band beat, you have to do like a lottery system. Here you just walk in, like we would get there like 10 minutes early and get a really great seat for it. And just that we pay 400 and whatever for our very expensive annual passes, the most expensive annual pass there, and we get to come and see the show is amazing to me. Mickey is really kind of the star of the show, although Minnie has the best outfits. And this year, Disney worked with the Moulin Rouge. And I believe for the women performers' outfits, I'm not sure, maybe the male as well. And then I'm sure Minnie's outfits also. So I just thought that was very interesting.
Well, last year, this show played at the Hyperion Theater, which had a much smaller capacity. Mm-hmm. We talked to all our friends that live out there, and they are all very, very happy that it moved over here to this theater.
And look at Minnie. Minnie has, I mentioned, about four outfit changes. And I'm sure this must have also been from the Moulin Rouge. And Disney had mentioned that, again, no facts and figures, but that was a big deal for them that they were, you know, working together. And so we have Mickey, Minnie, and Goofy. I think that's it as far as characters.
Not just Goofy, Santa Goofy.
Well, Santa
Goofy. Both Goofies, actually. But
yes, Goofy in several, in at least two different forms. And here is Minnie in one of her outfits. And she has another outfit that's sort of similar, but not exact in a minute.
Well, this is her big piano number. So, and she has a nice shawl there, which is the keys of the piano. And she is demonstrating her piano playing prowess as we're watching.
Well, I'm not sure she plays piano.
She plays a little. Does she? One finger.
I don't even remember that. But we saw this. I think I saw this three times. And I could have, if I could have seen this every day. It's just a beautiful, beautiful show. And you have Mickey and Minnie dancing. And this is before Mickey's big number on the drums.
Well, they're very formal there. Nice formal outfit. And I think now we're going to make the first viewing of a Goofy, Santa Goofy, they say, and Santa Claus is there. And they all point, and here comes Santa Goofy in the middle of the audience.
Because we've never seen Santa Goofy
before. Have seen such a thing before.
He actually does meet at Disney's Hollywood Studios as well, out in the courtyard. So you can meet Santa Goofy, not just see him on stage. It would be cool if you could actually meet Minnie in some of these outfits. But she looks really great. And then there's, again, like 30 performers. You've got the band to the left. You've got the piano player. You've got these performers who keep changing clothes. You know, the men, some of the men did like acrobatics, you know, did flips on stage. And then Goofy here is doing his kicks too.
Now, I had mentioned earlier about the theater, and this is actually the former Animagique Theater, which has a very good capacity, very comfortable seats. So I'm very glad. Now, here's one of the highlights for me of the whole show. It is Mickey on the drums.
And you can see him in Big Band Beat at Tokyo Disneyland, or Tokyo Disney Sea, I believe it is, playing the drums. But again, we've not been to Asia, so we got to see it here. The Animagique Theater otherwise will have very often Mickey and the Magician, and this is a stage that is on.
Another amazingly awesome show.
Disneyland Paris has terrific entertainment. I mean, I just can't say enough about their entertainment programs.
And I love Mickey's going to wipe the sweat off his brow because he just finished a little solo. So I thought that's a very nice touch. There he is.
And you can see this whole show on our channel, you know, without us talking about it. And we just wanted to kind of show the different segments and discuss them. But I guess we're heading towards more the end of the show now.
That's right. This is the big finale, and Mickey and Minnie and Goofy, everybody's going to come out on stage, and they're all going to do one big final number. First, though, Mickey has to get quickly changed and get off of the drum kit.
And I just, this show, I don't want to say sold out, because you're not paying for the show in particular, but it had a pretty good audience each day. But again, you could get there like 10 minutes early, and each time we could get in.
Well, we were lucky. It wasn't the busiest of times. Maybe Christmas week, it'll be a little harder to get in.
And look at Minnie's dress there. Again, similar to the one earlier. And now we have Santa Goofy.
I love this dance move. I don't mean to cut you off, but Mickey is about to do his big finale right there. So energetic.
So this is really such a terrific show. So if you get to go to Disneyland Paris, let's say next Christmas, just watch for what they're going to be offering next year, because this year's offerings, I think there was like 8 different shows, including the parade, and most of them were really fantastic.
Yeah, outstanding. As you said, this is my favorite thing. I think after the parade at Disneyland itself, that was my favorite event. Now we're going to look at that Gourmand one more time. Remember, I told you it's beautiful after dark, and there you are.
And again, I think this is called L'Hiver. And Gourmand. And I just really enjoyed it. I didn't get a lot here. I think we got a pretzel and a couple other items. But the mulled wine was really nice. And it's like the same company that does it, from what I was told, in Disney Village. So I had the hot wine a couple times. And in the Remy area, you have so many like decorations and lights, and it just is a lovely place. You can see the ground is wet. It's cold. But there was just, it was Christmas, and it felt like
very,
Christmas.
Very, very Christmassy. Super, super Christmassy. Now we're going to end off here with the finale show they do at park closing every night.
And this is called Goofy's Incredible Christmas. I didn't get close to it. You stood for like an hour once, and I just wasn't really up for that.
Yeah, I waited for a very cold night and stood an hour, figuring not many others would do it. And I guess I was kind of right, but it started to fill in still about a half hour before the show, and by the time the show started, it was packed.
I would probably do it next time, but this time I did not. And you have the various characters, and really I have to kind of watch it on your video because I watch it otherwise from really far back. And you have Goofy, Mickey, Minnie, again, in a different outfit. I think she has a couple costume changes here as well.
Now, there are advantages to being further back, and there are advantages to being close. Now, if you want to see the characters, I would highly recommend the front row. If you want to see the overall projection on the Tower of Terror and some of the pyrotechnics, then further back would be better. Now, what I think is interesting is their use of the video screens. See how they have other performers? They're not really there. So you have Goofy and Donald and Daisy are actually there, but you have the other performers that are projected, as is Santa Claus there, who is talking to Goofy, trying to help him out with his gift finding.
And I don't know if I must have realized that those performers weren't real, but I was mostly further back. The Tower of Terror looks great, and there's like the pyrotechnics look terrific. Their Tower of Terror really is very good for projections, and both times I stood back, one of them off to the side, so I could really just watch what was going on the tower, and that way I also didn't have to wait too long to see it.
Absolutely, absolutely. And here you're about to see a big surprise. I believe Mickey is about to make a special appearance in a very special outfit.
He kind of reminds me of in here at the Magic Kingdom prior.
Now you'll notice the toy soldiers there. Those are the classic toy soldiers we have here at the Walt Disney World. They are not really there. They are on the screen.
I don't know if I knew that. So it's
if you're in the front, it's a very different experience.
And then, I mean, they can just have it projected on. So that's cool. And I think
Goofy's not there at this time, and neither is Chip and Dale. So it's only Mickey on stage. But, you know, especially on video, it looks like they're all actually there. And even there's even shadow. What a great job. There's even shadow with Goofy.
That's really interesting. I mean, I don't think I've watched it. I haven't watched the video yet fully. I've only seen it from the back, so it's interesting to see how that looks up front. And there's Minnie, and that's really Minnie, and not really Goofy. And Minnie's in her ballet outfit again, another change. I mean, if you like seeing the different characters and different costumes for the holidays, you know, Disneyland Paris is kind of the place to go, and you can meet them in different outfits, but definitely during the shows even more.
Yeah, my recommendation for this is I would at least one time during your trip wait for the front row and just enjoy seeing the characters up close, and then just come on. If you are going to watch it from the back, you could show up right as the show starts, no problem, and you'll be able to see everything just fine.
It's really fun, and you know, even though it was sort of dreary and cold, it really lent itself to the holiday feeling.
And of course, it is snowing out. I can't tell if it's real snow or snope. I believe it was snope this night.
They have so much of the snow, like, everywhere, like, during the shows, in the big band Christmas and here and the parade and every half hour on Main Street. I mean, if you want to see snow, Disneyland Paris is also your place to go.
Yeah, I can't think of one show or event that happens that it doesn't snope out at.
And sometimes real snow.
That's true. And here they are, all the characters together, and they are all really there with Santa Claus.
And that was really fun that he came out after Santa, after seeing him projected. And again, we do have this whole show for you to enjoy on YouTube.
Yep, and then we'll link to that on our show notes. So overall, I would say Disneyland Paris, Walt Disney Studios, both combined, have a tremendous Christmas with no upcharge. It's all included with your daily ticket. That's another big bonus.
Yeah, I mean, again, we paid for our Infinity Pass, and I'm sure it'll go up at some point, but at $400 and some odd, and that is the most expensive annual pass to Disneyland Paris right now, and it gives us so many benefits. And then you get all these great shows.
Oh, I should mention they have an annual pass viewing area for this. And very interestingly, it's in the back.
Yeah, I did that once. And it was like, well, I don't know if this is the best place, but it's a good place because really there are a number of good locations. You can be up front or you can be in the back, and it's just totally different.
And here is what happens after that show ends. The park is now closed and everybody leaves at once.
I think I had already left.
You were smartly
out of
there.
I go to McDonald's or something. I probably went to McDonald's to get something to eat.
So now we're going to talk about something very different, and we're going to have a little tribute to your father.
And my dad passed away on November 26, 2018. We also left for Paris on November 26, 2018. We found out just before we left, and my family had said to go. But then we came back, and we just were at the services in Washington, D.C. And here he is. I just want to talk a little bit about him. He was blind in Vietnam. I've never known him to be sighted. But he has met like 7 presidents. The first was Ford. He met him at Arlington, and then President Ford invited him to the White House. Now, my dad here is with Reagan. He met him a couple times, and you have Chuck Hagel next to him. And he knew Chuck Hagel his whole life as well. And then he met President Obama. Out of this, it was 7 consecutive presidents, and President Obama was the last.
Didn't he meet him twice?
At least twice in the, for Veterans Day events. And I found this, I hadn't realized. He had told me I met John McCain. I have no idea if I did. But this was some sort of an event that I just, with John McCain. Tom Ridge spoke at his funeral, Secretary Ridge. And here is, he's been friends with him for like 35 years at least. And they really had a very, very good friendship. And they had lunch together at the National Press Club not too long ago. The National Press Club is somewhere my dad was a member for 25 years. Here is Donald Driver. When my dad received the AMVETS Award, Silver Helmet Award, Donald Driver also is receiving an award that day. And there I am with him. I've really been proud of him. His whole life, he is really, he was blinded. He's never complained about being blind. And then all he wanted to do was help others. And he had a column called Sergeant Shaft. Oh, and here he is being honored. Several sunset parades he has been honored with through the years, at least a few. And so there I am at a Flag Day picnic. He and 2 other veterans had started a foundation called the Blinded American Veterans Foundation. And he was president of that for like 35 years.
And we'll link to that in the show notes in case anybody wants to learn more about the foundation.
Right. And, and about my dad. And I had actually, and there you are, I had actually written up a Veterans Day tribute, which I didn't expect was just a couple of weeks before he passed away, which like the press club used in their article, just a little bit about that.
We'll link to that, of course, as well.
And, but anyway, I'm so proud of him and all that he's accomplished in his life. And I made this board up just for the services and such, just kind of showing just a little bit. I could only put like 30 or 35 pictures on there. It's very hard to, to sum up a life.
Well, such a life, board. Such a tremendous life. And what an honor it has been for me for the last 10 years or so to have met and got to know him. Just an amazing, amazing guy.
And I just, I'm really proud of him. And if you've made it this far in the show, I really appreciate you listening. And he was going to be at buried at Arlington in the spring, but we just found out it will be January. So I don't know if that week we might be just a tiny bit late on the show, but probably not too much since we'll only be gone a few days.
And thank you very much. We really appreciate everybody that stayed around and listened to Denise's tribute.
And thank you very much. And we will be talking more about, obviously, Disney next week. I'm not even sure all what we're going to talk about, but I have family coming in to Disney's Grand Floridian, I think, for a few days this weekend. And we're supposed to go to the Grand Floridian Cafe and I'm not sure even everything we're going to do. So it's going to be a surprise, whatever we're going to talk about next week. But we don't want to just talk about Christmas. Disney's Fort Wilderness Golf Cart Parade.
Of course, we will never miss the golf cart parade. And we should also say thanks very much to our sponsor, MEI Travel and Mouse Fan Travel.
Yes, we really appreciate them. Check their website out, please. And, if you're looking for a travel agent, they are excellent. They've been around 20 years. They have like 80 or 90 agents. They really do it right.
And we're happy to say they have just renewed for 2019. So I'm so glad we get to talk about them for another year.
Me too. So surprise for next week, but not a surprise with the Fort Wilderness Golf Cart Parade. That is something that we always try to do as far as Halloween, Christmas, and now 4th of July.
Oh yeah, that'll be wonderful. Fort Wilderness, it's almost 10 years in a row. I don't think we've missed one since 2009. At least missed a Fort Wilderness on Christmas Eve, special place for us.
I really love going there. And so maybe if you're over there, you'll see us around.
So thanks again for listening. Have a great week and also have a great Christmas or holiday.
Yes, happy holidays and Merry Christmas. I can't believe that's just around the corner now.
See you next week.